check.
All right, well, good morning.
Good morning.
I got a big mouth. Maybe I better lay this thing down.
Good morning, Joe.
All right, Mike, that's enough. All right, glad to see everyone here again this morning, and welcome you again to Christ Church and our Sunday morning Sunday school and hymn sing. So, as each and every week, just keep a smile on your face and sing along if you know them, all right?
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves. Jesus saves, bear the news to every land, find the mountains, cross waves, onward tis our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves,
wait it on
the rolling tide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves,
tell the sinners far and wide,
Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Sing ye islands of the sea, echo back you ocean waves. Earth shall keep her jubilee, Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Give the winds a mighty voice,
Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Let the nations now rejoice.
Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Shout salvation full and free.
Highest hills and deepest caves.
This our song of victory.
Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Jesus saves,
Jesus saves. That ought to wake you up.
Tomorrow, I don't see.
because he holds my hand, I can put all of my hope in him.
In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. 1 Peter 1:3.
Look for
Grace was given to us when he gave the one and only sacrifice on that cross and became Jesus Messiah.
Messiah,
Take your Bibles, please, and open with me to Genesis 31. Genesis 31. Now, this is a proof positive text that if you don't understand something, go back and read the chapter behind it or the chapter in front of it. Okay? Because chapter 30, you start reading about Jacob. First of all, Jacob served Laban 20 years. So that's a long time. 7 years for one daughter, 7 years for the other daughter, 6 years to gain some livestock. Okay? But he says that in, we're getting 31, that his dad-in-law changed his wages 10 times. So he just was actually going to have, and what does Jacob's name mean? I'm pulling your leg. That's exactly, he's sneaky. You remember he came out of his mother's womb holding on to Esau's foot. And it literally means pull your leg. And that's what he was a master at, is conniving. And I told you a couple of times that God has two wills. He has a permissive will, and he has a direct will, command will. Now, we're thinking over here, we're just doing whatever we want to do. No, you're not. You're only doing what God allows you to do. Because he's in control of every breath. He can stop you anytime, anywhere from anything, or he can induce you to do anything, anytime. God's in control. But occasionally, this permissive will runs head on into God's direct will. And when it does, it's not that God blessed all of the unchristian, ungodly stuff he did before, but he happened to get on the same page God was on, and God said, I got you. Okay? That kind of happened to me early on. I was called to preach when I was 17 years old, and I had no idea what to do with that. I mean, I didn't know any 17-year-old preachers. And I thought, well, yeah, I'm going to do what God asked me to do, but I don't have to get any hurry about it because all the preachers I knew is fat and bald-headed. I wasn't quite there yet, and so I thought I had time. And so I just kind of going along, cruising along, trying to dodge Vietnam and all that other stuff that was going on during that day. And so I was down here in Memphis when civil rights, Martin Luther King was killed. And, you know, I'm a country boy, bad country boy. And I looked around, National Guard was parked in the parking lot at Eastgate Shopping Center. They had a camp set up there. And there was curfews going on. I said, I don't know about, I just know Memphis is crazy. I'm going back to Union City. So I was in Memphis preparing for ministry. I was going to the Bible college. So I said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm going back home. I'm going over to the University of Tennessee, Martin. I'll find something to do. And I told you the story. The guy called me on Saturday night, and I ended up preaching for him on Sunday, and then they hired me. And all of a sudden, I looked around, and I was 19 and in the ministry. So it just, I thought I was running away from God. But God fooled me. He just got in front of me, and while I was looking over my shoulder, I ran up in his arms. And that's just the way it worked out. And so sometimes what this guy, what Jacob was doing in God's permissive will eventually collided with what God was going to do in his direct will. Now, chapter 30, if you read that, it's just going to boggle your mind. It's some kind of hocus pocus that Jacob was working to get all of the sheep spotted, striped, or dark colored. And so he had to know about genetics and how that worked. He had to, because that's the way it worked. But you start reading about those white sticks that he stripped off and put in the water troughs and stripped off and put in the feed trough, and that was supposed to make them fertile and supposed to make them do this, do that. And I read all that and I studied, and there's as much commentators either say nothing about what you're interested in, or they talk something to death that you don't care about. I just wanted to know what that was. And I got scientific studies, 3, 5, 6 pages long. And so I said, man, I'm not going to stand up here and try to explain that to the people. So let's just skip it for a minute, and it'll explain itself. We're going to chapter 31. Now, Jacob heard the words of Laban's sons, because he had gotten all these sheep. In fact, he now had more sheep than Laban did. And and Jacob heard the words of Laban's son. Jacob has taken away, come on, guys, all that was our father's, and he acquired all of his wealth. And Jacob saw the countenance of Laban had indeed, it was not favorable toward him as before. Then the Lord spoke to Jacob, return to the land of your fathers and to your family, and I will be with you. That's good to know, because who was waiting on him where his family was? Esau. You remember, he'd already cheated Esau out of his birthright and out of his blessings. So now he was caught between a rock and a hard place. To the north, Laban said, if I see you again, I'm going to hurt you. And Esau, they hadn't been in contact for 20 years. So Jacob had no idea what he was going to run into when he went back home. So have you ever been in that dilemma? It's kind of bad either way you go. But the blessing is God said, you go back to your daddy, I'll be with you. That's the side you want to pick every time, is one where God's going to be with you. Amen? Don't pick a side that God's not going to be with you. And it's not quite as clear sometimes to us. We've got a better compass, spiritual compass in us than any of the Old Testament guys ever had. We've got Holy Spirit living in us. That is God. And he can talk to us anyway through circumstances, through prayer, through Bible reading, through people. That God will give you some kind of word or some kind of confidence that you know what you're doing. But in that day, they didn't have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. God had to directly communicate to them through a prophet or through the Spirit and through the heart. And so they didn't speak to God very often, but when they spoke to God, they spoke to God. Okay, so he had that assurance that God was going to be with him. So Jacob sent and called Rachel and Leah to the field of the flocks, and he said to them, I see your father's countenance, that it is not favorable to me as before, but the God of my fathers has been with me, and you know that with all my might I served your father. And I do believe that's true. I believe he loved Rachel. And he would have done anything in his power to gain her as his wife, even if he had to take Leah first and then get Rachel second and had to work another 7 years. But he would have done anything he could to serve Laban because he loved that girl. Now, your father has deceived me and changed my wages 10 times, but God did not allow him to hurt me. Okay? Now, there are things that happen to us financially that we simply think is a disaster. But we're not in charge of how far our money goes. We can waste our money. We can be guilty of wasting our money. But God's got a way of bringing things to our life and bringing people into our life and bringing situations into our life where he can do a lot more for us than dollars could ever do. So we got to understand that even though he'd been deceived, even though Laban had changed his wages 10 times, God didn't allow it to hurt me. And he said thus, the speckle shall be your wages. Then all the flocks bore speckled, and it was thus, the streak shall be your wages. Then all the flocks bore streaks. Now, here's verse 9. Now, this is the answer to all of chapter 30. You read chapter 30, it's just a bunch of hocus pocus about this animal husbandry. Now, how can I say any of the Bible is hocus pocus? We're seeing it from Jacob's point of view, not God's point of view. God's point of view was, again, Jacob was using deception to convert the whole flock, out of deception, not magic or some kind of a spell, but he literally tricked Laban. God knew what was going on, but Jacob tricked Laban out of the biggest part of his flock. In fact, what he lost, let me explain this to you. Jacob had helped Laban a bunch. Laban was struggling and not doing very well. Who was the shepherdess that came to the water that day? Rachel. So he had, and I'm not putting down ladies. Ladies tougher than men. I didn't figure that out. Linda worked circles around me. She's a year older than me. But I'm telling you, he was down to using his immediate family, which at that time was two girls, to take care of his sheep. So he wasn't doing very well. And Jacob shows up. And for 20 years, Jacob was the farm manager. And what happened during that 20 years? I'm telling you, the flocks of Laban multiplied, triplified, and every other kind of fied. Okay? So it's not like Jacob has left Laban broke. He did not. But he figured out a way that every sheep on the farm had speckled, spotted, or off-colored babies, and all of them were his. So all of the flock of Laban, plus all of his flock, all had speckled, spotted, or striped sheep. What did that mean? They were all Jacob's. And Laban looked around, his sons looked around one day, and they said, "Good Lord, Jacob has deceived us. He's leaving us poor. He's taking all the flock." No, he took 1 year's interest. If you invest $10,000 at 10%, you can't do that, but if you can, you would expect at the end of the year, what? $1,000. Okay? But if you lost the 1,000, you didn't get anything that year, you didn't lose your 10. You understand? And that's kind of the situation. Laban didn't lose any of his flock, but he lost 1 year's worth of the babies. 1 year's worth of the babies. All of them were spotted, speckled, or off-colored. And so they all ended up with Jacob. And so verse 9 says, "So God has taken away the livestock of your father and given them to me." So all this over in chapter 30 was Jacob's efforts in what he knew, whether it was trickery or whether it was deception or whether it was some kind of genetic science that he'd figured out or whatever. But Jacob was doing it his way. He was doing it his way. But what did verse 9 say? "But it was God who took away the livestock of your father and has given it to me." Okay? You just don't know how that blessed me. God's trying to figure out how in the world am I going to preach chapter 30. It's just gobbledygook. I couldn't understand any of it. And when I went to check on commentaries, Lord, they was trying to explain it scientifically in every other way. But the answer is God. Again, Jacob was over here in his permissive, God's permissive will, but God's direct will happened to collide, and God wanted him to have all of those livestock. And it happened at that time when the flocks conceived that I lifted up my eyes and saw in a dream, and behold, the rams which leaped on the flocks were streaked, speckled, and gray-spotted. And then the angel of the Lord spoke to me in a dream, saying, "Jacob," and I said, "Here I am." And he said, "Lift up your eyes now and see all the rams that leap on the flocks are streaked, speckled, and gray-spotted. Excuse me. For I have seen all that Laban has doing unto you." Don't you feel like sometimes the world's screwing you over? and you don't think anybody cares. Nobody's paying attention. It's every man for himself. And you're just left out there hanging. God sees. God sees. And in God's time, God never disappoints or fails his children. He just ain't through yet. He's still working. I'm hung in the minute, and I'm just, I'm hung in the minute. God's not. God's timeless. So he knows how it's all gonna work. So he said, I have seen all the things that Laban has done to you. Now, where was I? Come on, somebody's supposed to be reading ahead of it. Huh? 13. Okay, he said, and so God says, I am the God of Bethel. You remember when Jacob saw the ladder and the angels coming up and down? That's Bethel. That's the house. Bethel is the house of God. The house of God. And he said, I am the same God of Bethel, where you anointed the pillar and where you made a vow to me. Now arise, get out of this land and return to the land of your family. Then Rachel and Leah answered and said to him, is there still any portion of our inheritance for us and our father's house? Are we not considered strangers by him? For he has sold us and also completely consumed our money. For all these riches which God has taken from our father are really ours and our children's. Now then, whatever God has said to you, do it. So the girls, now Rachel was not a believer. She had stolen the household gods. We don't hear about Leah. She just kind of had babies. And that was her thing. And but we know Rachel wasn't particularly a believer. She had the household gods. She stole them. But they both said, it's obvious to us that God's blessing is on our husband and has released our father. Our father has cheated us. He's cheated Jacob. And God is on Jacob's side. That's where we want to be. And so they were willing to say goodbye to their dad. And come on, husband, let's go. And so Jacob arose and set his sons and his wives on camels and carried away all the livestock and all the possessions which he had gained, his acquired livestock which he had gained in Padan Aram, to go to his father Isaac in the land of Canaan. Now Laban had gone to shear his sheep, and Rachel had stolen the household idols of her fathers. Jacob stole away, unknown to Laban, the Syrian, and he did not tell him that he intended to flee. So he fled and arose and across the river and headed toward the mountains of Gilead. Now, I want to stop there. There's some more inner workings of all of this, because Laban catches up with Jacob. Now, here's Laban's story. Laban's story is, you have stolen me blind, you have taken my daughters, and you have run away because you're a coward. That's what he called him. He said, you have gone away in the night, left without telling me, left without me kissing my daughters and without me hugging my grandchildren, and you've gone. You're a coward. No, but that's the way Laban saw it. Okay? And you know what? There's half-truths in that. Jacob, pretty sneaky. But Laban wasn't paying attention, and when he was paying attention, he was stealing back. So he's just about as bad as it could get. And so we're going to drop down to verse 43. And Laban answered and said to Jacob, these daughters are my daughters, and these children are my children, and this flock is my flock. All that you see is mine. But what can I do this day to those my daughters and to their children whom they have borne? Now therefore, Come, let us make a covenant, you and I, and let it be a witness between you and me. So Jacob took a stone and set it up as a pillar. Then Jacob said to his sons, gather stones. And they took stones and made a heap. They ate there on the heap. Laban called it, hard word, but Jacob called it Galeed, which will eventually be Galilee. But Laban said, this heap is a witness between you and me this day. Therefore, the name of this place is called Galeed. Also Mitzvah, because he said, Laban said, may the Lord watch between you and me while we are absent one from another. And if you afflict my daughters, take other wives besides my daughters, although no man is with us, see, God is witness between you and me. And Laban said to Jacob, here's the heap, and here's the pillar which I have placed between you and me. The heap is a witness. This pillar is a witness that I will not pass beyond the heap to you, and you will not pass beyond this heap to this pillar of this pillar to me for harm. And the God of Abraham, the God of Nahor, the God of your father, judge between us. And Jacob swore by the fear of his father, Isaac. Now, that's read all the time as a blessing. May the Lord watch between me and you while we are absent one from another. Isn't that pretty? That's not what it meant. What Laban was saying, if I see your raunchy tail again, I'm going to hurt you. Now get on out of here. That's what that blessing was. The Lord better watch between me and you, because if I see you again, I'm going to hurt you. It wasn't such a sweet blessing. And you have to read the whole thing. I mean, it was, they were angry, they were fussing, they were fighting. And this was as much a threat as it was a blessing. May the Lord watch between you and me. Keep us apart so we don't hurt each other. And he said, as we're absent, one for the other. The best way for them to be is absent, one from another. I've run into some situations in family and in counseling and in every other way. I can truly say there's nobody I hate. Hatred only hurts you. If you're hating somebody, they don't know it. They don't even care. But it's keeping you up at night. So it's kind of stupid to punish yourself with hatred. Okay? So you got to get that cleaned out. You go to God and you just forgive him. So God, I forgive him. And when you say that, God will help you forgive him. But there's still some folks I don't want to be around no more. I'm not hateful. And if they get around me, I'll be peaceful. But if I have a choice, I just break. There is no need. If you see a man just sitting there swinging his fist, you are stupid to walk into that fist. You just stupid. That's kind of like trying to stop a electric saw with your hand. You can do it. You can do it, but you don't want to pay the price to do it. And so there are people who are toxic people. Amen. And they're going to hurt you. But if you end up hating them or end up dreaming of how to get even or scheming, that's only hurting you. You got to let that go. And I tell you exactly how I did it. I said, God, I forgive them. Make me feel that way. I chose to forgive. Then I had to ask God to catch my feelings up with the decision that I'd already made. He did. He did. I've learned one thing, man. Hatred and bitterness will kill you. And at our age, we end up with some bitterness and we end up with some pain. You just don't get this far in life without it hurting. It's the way it is. But you can control how much you let somebody else hurt you. Okay? And so I'm just being honest as I can be. These two guys left on good terms. I'll take my stuff and go back home. You take your stuff and go home. And we're going to call it a tie, but if I see you again, we'll hurt you. Okay? And so that was what was in this message. Now, in the next chapter, we're going to end up at Bethel. What is Bethel? House of God. He has to go back to Bethel and reestablish what he had started there. He saw God and God said, I'm going to take care of you and I'm going to bless you. So it was time for him to go back to Bethel and start his journey toward Esau, so that, you know, he didn't know what he was fixing to run into when he got into Esau, because Esau married one of Ishmael's kinfolks. Who was Ishmael? He was the illegitimate son of Abraham. And so they were Arabs. This conflict that's going on right now started right here. My guide used to say, I don't know why we can't get along. We're all brothers. And I said, well, the guy with the gun generally is in control. Okay? And so basically that was going to be Israel. And I have no way of knowing if this generation that's in Israel now is going to be the generation when Jesus comes back. I mean, they could go off the map again. They can come back again. But since the dispersion, or since the Roman destruction of Jerusalem, for 2,000 years, there had been no Israel, or for 1948 years, until after World War II, they were given back the land. But can you not understand the Arab position? They'd been there for 2,000 years, thought it was theirs. They thought it was theirs. And now the UN has just given it to these Jews who had been gone. And yes, there's some of them still there forever. But all of a sudden, they're saying, you're taking our land. And the Jews are saying, no, it's our land. And one of the things they've done, for those of you who've been there, just south of where you go into the old city and go down to the Wailing Wall, right across the street is the old city of David. Siloam, or Siloam, the pool of Siloam. It's at the bottom of the hill. That hill, not the mountaintop where the temple is, but that hill was the city of David. And and it was covered. The whole, there was an offshoot, a hill that had valley on each side. It's called Siloam. And it was literally covered up with Muslims. The Jews knocked on the door, handed them a piece of paper, said, by eminent domain, we're taking your property, you get zero, you got 2 days to move. And they ran all the Arabs off that hill because they started excavating the city of David. To do what? To prove that it was Jewish before it was ever Arab. That's why they're digging like they're, that's why they're doing all the archaeological work, is not because they want to endear themselves to God and to the history of the Bible. They want to prove to the Arabs it was theirs before the Arabs. And that's what they're going about. So it's a mess over there. It will continue to be a mess over there. But I have read the last chapter, and I just wouldn't bet against Israel. That'd be a bad bet. You understand? So I'm just saying. So what again is the lesson? The lesson is that it's God, it's God, it's God. Amen. It's God. Jacob did everything he could to be sneaky. And Laban did everything he could do to be mean. But who won? God did. God worked in spite of Jacob. God worked over Laban. And God worked What is all this about? Establishing a people of God who were going to bring Jesus into the world. And this is 2,000 years before Jesus. You understand? They're trying to figure it all out. So it's actually 4,000 years before Jesus. But anyway, but all of this is the hand of God working to bring about Jesus, the God-man who died for our sins and proved that it worked by escaping death and the grave. You understand? We too are going to escape. When you read at funerals that the body is sown in weakness and it's raised in power, it's sown this way. It's sown in weakness. Somebody had to carry the casket over there. But it's raised in power. The Greek word for power is dunamis. We get an English word from it. Dynamite. When God gets you, I laugh when I go to these cemeteries. They got stone boxes, you know, they put in the casket in. They got, some of them are elaborate, aren't they, Joe? They got all kinds of, and it's like they're preserving the body. I don't want my body preserved. I want it resurrected. The preserved body still stinks. Okay? I went up to Union City a couple of weeks ago. Went to Real Foot Lake at my catfish. And then I came back by my church, family's church, and the cemetery where four generations of my people are there. And I carried Linda to the foot of my granddaddy's grave. I said, now when I die, I want to be cremated. I want you to dig a hole right there and drop me in that hole and leave. I don't even care if you put up a marker. Don't make me no difference. 5 years, y'all won't care anyway. I went to my dad and mother's grave a couple of times after they died. Hadn't been anymore. I was sitting there on tombstone one day talking to daddy, and I said, stupid. You can do that in Memphis, same as you can in Union City. He ain't there no how. And so, you've just kind of learned through the years that you ain't as important as you thought you were. You can be gotten over pretty quick. About 5 years, all it takes. You're gone. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you work. That's what this passage shows us, that you're working now in our lives, in the lives of this church, and in the lives of the people. And whatever you're doing is for our good, because that's who you are. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, some of you are not going to be able to stay for the second hour, and so Jim and I will serve communion down here.